Oh my god, we just had WWE Night of Champions 2013. Let me tell you guys something. This show was absolutely garbage. It was garbage. I don't know how much to say it. It was just absolutely terrible. In fact, YWF Mayhem was better than this. And if you guys don't know what YWF Mayhem is, check out the suggested videos that's going to pop up here, or just check out my channel in general. But let me just talk about the show, okay? We open up with a Raw segment. We pretty much got a Raw segment where Triple H is like, I'm the game, the main event, and tonight, I want Daniel Bryan versus Randy Orton in a fair one-on-one contest. And now comes Paul Heyman, okay? He's like, Triple H, I have a problem with this match. I have a problem facing off against CM Punk tonight. I mean, I'm just a man in my mid-40s. And then Triple H is like, you're right, should be a no DQ match. And then Curtis Axel was like, well, you know what, Hunter? On May 20th, I defeated you in that very ring. I remember that. And Triple H is like, ho-ho, cool. You remember fucking dates. Well, guess what, motherfucker? Your title's on the line. So which leads to Curtis Axel taking on Kofi Kingston. This match overall was just decent. That's all I can really say about it. It was just decent. The last 3 minutes worth watching, I would say. Good stuff for the last 3 minutes. A weird camera angle when Kofi hit the SOS because they cut it off when Curtis Axel kicked out pretty much. But Curtis Axel ends up retaining the IC title. Good for Curtis Axel to get a big win like this. The match got a lot of time for it, for what it was. But like I said, it was just decent at best. There wasn't anything to it that really made me say, oh my god, this match was great. It was just decent. And now we move on to the Divas Championship match, and we have the Divas segment where AJ's like, oh, you guys are still my friends, right? And all the Divas are like, psh, get bitch, get the fuck out of here. So pretty much AJ took on the rest of the Total Divas people, and oh my god, this match was rushed, it was sloppy, it wasn't good. This four-way Divas match wasn't good, okay? There was like a huge blunder in this match, and I understand people are like, oh, well, you know, it was to set up a spot for Natalya, and yeah, okay, I understand it was supposed to set up a spot for Natalya, but Brie Bella was laying on top of Naomi for like, I don't know how long you can count, probably like 10 seconds. That should have been a 1, 2, 3. Natalya was even confused. She was like, wait, what do I do next? And so Natalya goes and hits the double sharpshooter. And that was a cool spot. But AJ goes and hits the Black Widow on Natalya. And out of all the Divas in this match, I would think that maybe Naomi would lose this match. Would tap out to the Black Widow. Or, you know, Brie Bella, I can understand. You don't want her to, you know, the Bella Twins are big things in WWE. Whether us people like her or not, they're big in the WWE in terms of the Total Divas show and everything. But Natalya. Natalya is the one that taps out tonight, and especially because tonight's Total Divas is all about her and her wedding with Tyson Kidd. Makes no sense to me why she has to tap out, because if anyone of the Total Divas people that you would think could take the Divas title away from AJ Lee, I would say it's Natalya. Maybe, hopefully this builds up to an AJ Lee and Natalya feud, because I actually think that would be a solid Divas feud. But yeah, now let's move on forward to Rob Van Dam versus Ricardo Rodriguez. So apparently, World Heavyweight Championship in Spanish means RVD. Cool, man. I don't even care. But crowd was hot as hell for this match, mainly because we're in Michigan. RVD's from Battle Creek, Michigan. I don't know if it's too far up from Detroit, but whatever. RVD pretty much dominated most of this match in the beginning. And then Del Rio came back using his same old arm technique that he always does. This match was very, like, stale. I would just say it was a very stale match. It felt like I've already seen this match somewhere, someplace, somehow. And I wasn't really too fond of this match, and the ending of the match was just ridiculous to me. I mean, it was such a lame duck ending. Like, Alberto Del Rio does not let go after the 5 count. I mean, that's dumb. That's dumb. And cool, Ricardo Rodriguez saved RVD from getting his ass kicked. But really, to be honest, we can't just have a clean finish for this pay-per-view. Why not have RVD win and then Damian Sandow cash in? I mean, I would rather see that than nothing at all, but instead, RVD kicks the shit out of Del Rio after the match, so you make your champion look like shit. The challenger looks too strong, in my personal opinion, at the end of this. RVD looked way too strong, because not only did he survive the cross arm breaker, but he also survived, you know, an onslaught from Del Rio the whole time, and then he makes Del Rio look like a bitch. Del Rio did not even look like a winner this whole show. He looked like a complete loser, and that sucks for the World Heavyweight Champion. I mean, seriously, I did not understand what the point of that was. Speaking of not understanding what the point of it was, The Miz versus Fandango, Miz wins. That's all you need to know. Miz wins. That's all you need to know. Curtis Axel and Paul Heyman taking on CM Punk. Okay. This was a no DQ match. Match was entertaining in the beginning. Then it got boring. Then CM Punk pulled a boom, 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 boom. He did pull a John Cena. If you guys are going to deny that, you can just deny it in your own little world. In my world, he pulled a John Cena. And he pretty much, you know, said, GTS, Anaconda Vice, CL by Curtis Axel. And so now we get down to the CM Punk and Paul Heyman whooping, which was actually pretty funny and enjoyable. I actually enjoyed that part of the match. But all of a sudden, out of the whips of nowhere, Ryback comes out and spears CM Punk through the table. Okay, and this leads to Paul Heyman winning the match. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, I like that they're making CM Punk lose this match. Because CM Punk needs to get a rebuilding process. He's been champion for 434 days at one point, and right now he's not really getting that much big wins. And so that way it makes us excited when we see him have that success type again. That's great shit. But why in the blue hell is Ryback now a part of this storyline? Like, he already has Brock fucking Lesnar. I understand Brock Lesnar is an attraction. But he already has Brock fucking Lesnar. Why is Ryback a part of this? Was Ryback and CM Punk such a great feud last year? Was everyone saying, oh, we gotta see that Ryback versus CM Punk? No, a lot of people were actually bitching and moaning about that. Honestly, I don't understand the point of this. Ryback had his own good little character that he was doing. Why associate him with Paul Heyman? I just think it's a waste for Ryback. I don't understand the point of having Ryback be with Paul Heyman. I mean, if anything, if they wanted to do this, they should have just done a spot where CM Punk throws Curtis Axel, he breaks the barricade, or throws him over the entrance ramp where Curtis Axel's laid out for a while. This is where CM Punk starts beating on Paul Heyman because CM Punk thinks like, oh, Curtis Axel is out of commission. Then out of nowhere, Curtis Axel fucking perplexes him through the damn table, and then later on, Paul Heyman gets to win that way. I don't understand Ryback being involved. If you guys do, comment down below because I don't understand what Ryback gains out of being part of this stable. I just don't understand what he gains. It makes no sense to me. It just feels random, forced, out of place. Dean Ambrose took on Dolph Ziggler for the U.S. title. Dean Ambrose retained his U.S. title. This was a solid SmackDown match. That's all I gotta say. The tag team match between The Shield and millions of dollars, the primetime players, the primetime players. Well, you know what? I gotta say, this was actually a fun tag team match to watch. Wasn't the best tag team match you're going to see, but the primetime players are definitely the next. Yo, 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 it's Shad Gaspard and JTJ, it's crime time, baby. So they're the next, you know, crime time pretty much. They're going to get a bunch of tag title shots and never win those damn belts when they should. I really do like the primetime players. I hope they do get a tag team title shot or at least a tag team title win in the near future. But I really did like this match right here. I thought it was very entertaining. It wasn't the best match of the night. It was a good, decent match, but I just felt the storytelling in this match was very good. I like how the primetime players came from the tag team turmoil earlier in the night and were able to wrestle this match and still look like champions to me. Both teams looked out good in the process. So now we get on to the main event of the evening. But wait. What's that? Oh, yeah, we were doing polls the whole night to see who are the best champions of all time. You know, Sting 1-1, Trish Stratus, Booker T. You know, these people won some awards, but the award for the greatest WWE champion of all time. Oh, brother. What you gonna do, brother? Because Hulkamania was ranked the number one WWE champion of all time, dude. And there's nothing that you guys can say to deny it. Stone Cold Steve Austin, brother, does not even compare to the almighty Hulkster. CM Punk, you may have had one of the greatest reigns in WWE in the last decade, dude, but Hulkamania still ran wild for 8 more years than you did, brother, as a WWE champion, dude. And then not only that, John Cena, I can see you just fine, bitch, because Hulkamania is still the greatest at Austin 316. As much as I respect you, dude, as much as I love you, dude, you are still not as great as the almighty Hulkster, brother. Oh, yeah, and Triple H, suck it. Hulk Hogan, man, he won the greatest WWE champion of all time, brother. What else can I say? But now time for the WWE championship match. Randy Orton taking on Daniel Bryan. I found this match to be really good. Probably the best match of the night of this shit show. Honestly, best match of the night. It was funny. All the matches were so bad before this match, besides maybe the tag team match, in my personal opinion, that this match looked great. Okay? That's just me. It looked great. And Randy Orton and Daniel Bryan, they pull off a good match. There was a random ref bump in between, and everyone was like, oh, this is going to be an interference, but Triple H said earlier in the night, there's no interference. So there wasn't going to be an interference. Another referee comes out. You know, Randy Orton survives the no lock, or the yes lock, or the LaBelle lock. What the fuck is it called, people? I don't know. I can't remember. Anyways, the match itself keeps on going. The original referee was like, came back in the ring, like, hey, other referee, get the fuck out. I'm the original ref. And the other ref was like, all right, bro, whatever, man. So pretty much, you know, it was kind of weird how this the original ref came back. And this set up a cool ending sequence where, you know, Daniel Bryan, he was about to get hit by, I believe it was Randy Orton's, like, power slam or one of Randy Orton's RKOs. I can't remember. So blurry. Just my contacts were fucking up during this match, which pissed me off. But it's hard to talk about the ending, guys. You guys know why. Daniel Bryan hits Randy Orton with a kick, knee to the face, and the referee screws my boy out of the WWE Championship. Did you guys not see that fast count? The referee went, he didn't count correctly. Randy Orton got screwed out of the WWE Championship. He got screwed. It's bullshit, man. Congrats to Daniel Bryan, though. Honestly, he got screwed, Randy Orton. And I honestly don't know how to react to this. You know, Daniel Bryan just won. By hook or crook, he just won. He's still not better than my boy. Randy Orton is still the face of the WWE, people. He is what we need. Daniel Bryan may have won, but Randy Orton is what we need. And in all honesty, Daniel Bryan winning this title, it's going to be an interesting Monday Night Raw. Not going to lie. It's going to be very interesting to see how this Monday Night Raw plays out with Daniel Bryan as the WWE Champion. People were like, wait, isn't it too soon? No, it's not too soon to give someone a title. Both men, no matter what, win or lose, whoever won this match, whoever lost this match, we're going to come out as winners because there was still going to be, one, featured in the main event scene, two, be featured in the WWE title scene, and three, most likely have a long-lasting feud. Both men were going to be winners of the night, no matter who won or lost. I just wish my boy Orton would have won it. It's kind of hard, you know. Last pay-per-view, we were all celebrating Randy Orton winning the title, and now it's like Daniel Bryan. And guys, it's not because I'm a Daniel Bryan hater, just know I'm a huge Orton fan. But that's pretty much it for the Night of Champions. This pay-per-view gets a C-. Yeah, that's like the lowest pay-per-view I gave this year. A C- to a D+. The show was just slow, boring, only two really decent matches on this card. Anyways, if you guys like me, you can subscribe by clicking down below. Like this video, dislike this video, check out the Supper Club. You guys know who it is. Randy Orton number 2, Justin Peck from the Tree of Woe show. The John Cena of the Supper Club, the beautiful, marvelous Mark, 80bikes28, and our leader, our God. No questions about it. The man who makes us what we are. The Schleg Daddy from Schleg Daddy TV and OTR Central. See, that's how much of a god he is, people. He has two accounts to grace us with his presence. Anyways, guys, I am out of here. Namaste to you all. Have a good Sunday. Oh, by the way, quick little channel update. Q&A will be posted Tuesday. And on that Tuesday, I'm going to do it right when I get home from the Grand Theft Auto Midnight release here in my town. So there's not going to be a Raw review tomorrow, because just understand, people, Grand Theft Auto is coming out tomorrow, and I got to be in line for it. So there's not going to be a Raw review tomorrow, but on Tuesday in midnight, you will see a Q&A for me as well with an unboxing of my Grand Theft Auto 5. I just got the regular edition. Yeah, it's boring, but I think you guys would like to see me at midnight with fucking bags under my eyes, all tired and shit. Anyways, I'm out of here, guys. Namaste. Peace.